Hello again, everybody, and a warm welcome from the sunny UK to today's online service.
And as always, we give a very special welcome to everyone from King's Church International in Windsor and London in the UK, and particularly to all those of you in Robertson, South Africa, where we hear that the cases of COVID are spiking. Just know that we are praying for you very much in our thoughts and our prayers.
Today, as we follow the story of the book of Acts, we come to chapter 15, where Paul and Barnabas found themselves having to stand up for the freedom of the gospel message of grace. This resulted in a big dispute which was handled in a godly way that helped the church move forward. And today also Robert and Maria Magambe, part of our team of 12 in the UK, they are going to share some important lessons about handling conflicts.
And on that theme, we will be having a special feature from some of our team of 12 in South Africa about how South Africa has faced up to the need for racial reconciliation. We'll also see why, as a church, we need to continue to play our part in the healing of many ongoing wounds, and why we have to keep on developing King's Church International as a multiracial Christian community.
Absolutely. Well, here in the UK, we were very happy to return last Sunday to the Theatre Royal in Windsor for our first service there after the absence of more than 16 months.
Well, it was great to be back, wasn't it?
It was amazing. And it was a very moving and powerful time. And we loved being able to meet together and worship together with a new freedom. My husband even sang a great, great old hymn at the one point, and everyone joined in. It was very, very, very powerful. Well, we will be having a report on this later, but first, let's pray together. Please, where you are, maybe open your heart and bow your heads.
Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for your great love and your faithfulness to us, Lord, in so many different situations. Thank you, Lord, for the opportunity that we had to come back together, to meet together with one another and in your presence back in Windsor. And Lord, we pray that you will continue to help us all. And we pray particularly that you will watch over in a very special way all our brothers and sisters in Robertson, in South Africa. We pray that you would help that great country. We pray, Lord, that the situation with the COVID, Lord, may change for the better. And you would help us as we help the people who have particular needs at this time. We pray for anybody watching this program, whatever their needs may be, we say, come, Holy Spirit, may we know your presence, may we know your power, may we know your touch upon our hearts and our lives in a new way. And we ask all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Now let's worship the Lord.
surface of my anxious imagination beckons a calmness that is found in you alone. It washes over every doubt, every imperfection. Jesus, your presence is the comfort of my soul. There's nowhere I'd rather be when you're singing over me. I just wanna be with you. I'm lost in your mystery. I'm found. Here in the waiting, I won't worry about tomorrow. No need to focus on the things I can't control. All my attention on the
1 Corinthians 1 verse 10. I appeal to you, brothers and sisters, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ,
that all of you agree with one another in what you say, and that there be no divisions among you, but that you be perfectly united in mind and thought.
Romans 14 verse 19. Let us, therefore, make every effort to do what leads to peace and to mutual edification.
Ephesians chapter 4 verses 1 to 6. As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling you have received. Be completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace.
There is one body and one Spirit, and just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all.
Chronicles 30 verse 12. Also in Judah, the hand of God was on the people, to give them unity of mind, to carry out what the king and his officials ordered, following the word of the Lord.
Psalms 133 verse 1. How good and pleasant it is when God's people live together in unity.
A new day, and we can't wait to celebrate together and see the power of God as we all get to come together and worship in community. It's really exciting and we just can't wait.
16 months, we're here, we're ready, we're anointed, and Jesus Christ is going to move this morning.
And I say amen and amen to that.
Said in this morning,
being in my final year at uni, trying to do that at home, it was really challenging. So I think the online services really made me realize I get my strength from God, and just really helped me, really. So yeah.
Thank you.
I knew I had the prayers of people in church and people singing that song with me as I sang it out loud in the hospital. I didn't care who heard. I was going to give praise to God.
We have got to train every Christian to stand strong in the Lord and in His mighty power, that when God is in you, greater is He who is in you than he who is in the world. And no matter what comes against you, dear brothers and sisters, nothing is going to separate you from the love of God. No weapon of the enemy that is against you will prevail against you. And when Jesus is in the boat with you, you cannot sink. It's impossible to sink. He will get you safely to where you need to go. Oh,
Christ is the first and the last. He is
standing. It was like we hadn't been away.
Amazing to worship together again. Beautiful.
I didn't realise how much I missed it. It's great just to be together. Super, super encouraging.
Yeah, it was amazing. I was enjoying praising and just going all out, singing to God, and just having everyone to do it together.
And trust Him for all that's to come.
Wow.
Conflict has a long history in South Africa, dating as far back as history is recorded. The various groupings that have inhabited and still inhabit these shores have all at some point or another come into conflict with other groupings within the country. It is well known that at the end of apartheid, South Africa came perilously close to all-out war between its various inhabitants with their divergent interests. It would have been understandable if Nelson Mandela would have been so angry at his former jailers that he fueled the flames of hatred. Yet, he overcame his own considerable pain as he sought to understand and learn the language of his Afrikaner captors and eventually work with them on the long walk to freedom. He said, "If you want to make peace with your enemy, you have to work with your enemy. Then he becomes your partner." He recognized that his dream of all peoples and races living together peacefully in South Africa would demand a lot of change and healing. At his inauguration as president on 10 May 1994, Nelson Mandela said, "The task at hand will not be easy, but you have mandated us to change South Africa from a land in which the majority lived with little hope to one in which they can live and work with dignity, with a sense of self-esteem and confidence in the future." This was said against the background of a country that was long governed by a minority regime that brutally oppressed the majority population. Many people were kidnapped, tortured, and killed, and their bodies were disposed of by death squads, leaving remaining loved ones with only questions and suspicions of what had happened to them. After 1994, the people needed answers to their questions and confirmation of their suspicions so that South Africans could start on the road to reconciliation. By uncovering the truth about human rights violations that had occurred during the period of apartheid. For this purpose, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission, or TRC, was founded in 1995. The TRC focused more on gathering evidence and information than on prosecuting perpetrators, which distinguishes it from the Nuremberg trials that followed World War II. People simply wanted to hear from those who had been guilty of acts of violence and murder, "I did it, I was wrong, and I'm sorry." There were often scenes of great emotions as the scale of apartheid violence became clear and families discovered how their loved ones had been murdered.
On the 15th of April, 1996, the Truth and Reconciliation Commission took its seat for the first time in the East London City Hall. The road ahead was an unknown one. As Archbishop Desmond Tutu symbolically opened proceedings, a solemn hymn swept through the audience. Over the next 14 months, hymns and songs and prayer would become the familiar and comforting rituals in the many moments of great stress or sadness. The first victims to speak before the commission came from the struggle womb of the Eastern Cape. widows who carried the names of men who had become icons of liberation. But then there were the other brave pioneers of the South African truth process, the ordinary people who spoke about lives that had changed forever after torture, bullets, or bombs. As they spoke the first words in the great telling of our past, their words were relayed by television and radio to millions of South Africans and the world. There were those who spoke of loved ones who never returned from their cells.
It is 25 years now, and that I will not forget what happened.
The heartache of the past was illustrated too by the agony of betrayal, those who broke in the torture room or on apartheid's battlefield. From the small dusty schools and churches of the Platteland to the big imposing halls in the cities, the voices of victims tugged and tore at those who were prepared to listen. Their dignity and strength, their sadness and pride. And when pain threatened to overwhelm, there were always those who were amazed with forgiveness.
The TRC process eventually concluded, but South Africans are today still in need of daily reconciliation in order to achieve the dignity, sense of self-esteem and confidence in the future that President Mandela spoke of. Today, there are many people or organizations who are trying to achieve these objectives. King's Church International is certainly one of those and is playing a significant role in bringing healing to old wounds. My family and I, along with many others in Robertson, are thankful to be part of a church that models a multiracial community where everyone is welcome, regardless of their racial or cultural makeup, because we are one in Christ.
Hi all, my name is Robert Magembe and this is my wife, Maria. We are part of the leadership team here at KCI Windsor and we are so privileged to speak to you today on a very important subject of how to solve conflict. Now, of course, we live in a world of conflicts of many kinds. Conflicts can develop so easily even when people love one another. Maria and I have been happily married for 15 years, but we have discovered that one of the great secrets of staying happily married is learning how to overcome differences or disagreements. Maria and I have similarities, but we are very much different people. We are both from East Africa. She's originally from Uganda, and I'm originally from Tanzania.
I grew up in Zimbabwe and Robert in Botswana.
My first language is Swahili.
And my first language is English.
I like to have music playing all over the house, all the time.
I need to be in the mood to listen to music.
I like my food warm, almost cold.
And I like my food piping hot.
I set the shower to lukewarm temperature.
I like setting it to be very hot.
Windows opened when I sleep.
Closed.
Christmas presents opened on Christmas Day after church.
Christmas presents opened at midnight. Why wait? It's Christmas after all.
As trivial as these differences are, we have had to learn not to let them damage the love between us. We have a rule not to go to bed with unsolved issues. I don't know what conflicts you may face, but it is so important to handle them in the right way. Thomas Crum, known throughout the world as the conflict resolution expert, having advised big corporate companies, national sporting teams, and the Navy SEALs, says, "The quality of our lives depends not on whether or not we have conflicts, but on how we respond to them." Unresolved conflicts can lead to divisions of many kinds between couples, families, businesses, nations, and even churches. This is what we see in our reading today as we continue our studies from the book of Acts. Chapter 15 begins with Paul and Barnabas coming into serious conflict with a particular group who wanted to tie non-Jewish believers to Jewish traditions. And it ends with Paul and Barnabas themselves actually having a big argument and going their separate ways. So we see that the Bible deals with real life situations, but also we can learn how conflicts handled in the right way can actually work out for good. Let's start by reading from Acts chapter 15, verses 1 and 2. It says, certain people came down from Judea to Antioch and were teaching the believers, unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. This brought Paul and Barnabas into sharp dispute and debate with them. So Paul and Barnabas were appointed, along with some other believers, to go up to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this question.
So from this chapter, we can see some valuable points as well as lessons on conflict resolution. Firstly, we need to accept that some conflicts are necessary. The apostles Paul and Barnabas totally believed in the love of God and the need to do everything possible to live in unity. But they also knew that unity is not possible in situations where there are basic issues at stake that must be defended. The basic issue here was over the core gospel message of how you are saved from your sins. In short, do you need to follow traditions and religious rituals to become a Christian, or is it all by grace and faith in Christ? As we have seen in our reading, Paul and Barnabas strongly and sharply disagreed with the view that was being spread by some Jewish teachers from Judea who were insisting that unless you are circumcised according to the custom taught by Moses, you cannot be saved. Later on in Acts 15, verse 5, some of the believers who belonged to the party of the Pharisees insisted that the Gentiles must be circumcised and required to obey the law of Moses. In other words, these people were saying that Gentiles could not be saved without accepting the obligations of the Jewish law. Paul and Barnabas could not and would not give ground on this issue. Paul had preached, as we read in Acts chapter 13, verse 39, that through him, everyone who believes is set free from every sin, a justification you were not able to obtain under the law of Moses. Paul and Barnabas were prepared to enter into sharp conflict with those who threatened the church. Later, Paul used very strong language against the group who were stirring up trouble for the believers. He wrote in Galatians chapter 5, verse 12, as for those agitators, I wish they would go the whole way and emasculate themselves. Paul and Barnabas understood that they had to face head-on this crisis that threatened the unity and nature of the church. There was no middle ground. It was therefore extremely necessary to fight for the right. They therefore traveled to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this issue. Acts 15, verse 4 tells us that they reported everything God had done through them. As Christians, we too must always seek to be peacemakers. But when there is basic principles of truth and righteousness at stake, we must be ready to fight the good fight of faith, as 1 Timothy 6, verse 12 says. The truth of the gospel and the help of the Holy Spirit will equip and empower us to persevere through any trial and stand our ground for the truth. Psalm 55, verse 22 says, cast your cares on the Lord and he will sustain you. He will never let the righteous be shaken. As a church, we must also be on guard against division springing up from different backgrounds or cultural traditions, remembering that our common denominator is salvation by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone. Ephesians 2 verse 8 reminds us, for it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, it is the gift of God.
So, some conflicts are necessary and must be faced. The next point is that conflict should be faced in a godly way. How do you handle conflict? Do you bury your head in the sand like an ostrich and hope it goes away? Or do you go to it and seek resolution? This is exactly what Paul and Barnabas did. They sought to meet with the elders to discuss this matter of who is a real Christian. Nelson Mandela said as he left office that all conflicts, no matter how intractable, are capable of peaceful resolution. I truly believe this, and from the text, we can see a process of dealing with disagreements. This is great in situations at home, work, and in the church where our story is set. From verse 2, we read, "This brought Paul and Barnabas into sharp dispute and debate with them. So Paul and Barnabas were appointed, along with some other believers, to go up to Jerusalem to see the apostles and elders about this question." From this verse, we see that you need to meet together. Paul and Barnabas were chosen and sent to meet the apostles and elders to discuss the sharp disagreement they had. Verses 6 and 7 say, "The apostles and elders met to consider this question. After much discussion, Peter got up and addressed them." The Message version puts it like this: "The apostles and leaders called a special meeting to consider the matter. The arguments went on and on, back and forth, getting more and more heated." This sounds like an accurate description of any modern day courtroom. In a meeting like this, the apostles were following the teaching of Jesus to do all you can to resolve conflicts. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 5, verses 23 and 24, "Therefore, if you are offering a gift at the altar and there remember that your brother or sister has something against you, leave your gift there in front of the altar. First, go and be reconciled with them, then come and offer your gift." And also in Matthew chapter 18, Jesus said we should go and point out the fault of a fellow believer. In verses 15 and 16 of Matthew chapter 18, he said, "If your brother or sister sins, go and point out their fault just between the two of you. If they listen to you, you have won them over. But if they will not listen, take one or two others along so that every matter may be established by the testimony of two or three witnesses." We should not be afraid of conflict. When two sides meet to discuss matters equally important to all parties, it is highly likely that there will be passionate discussions among them. So, you need to listen to one another. In Acts chapter 15, verse 12, it says, "The whole assembly became silent as they listened to Barnabas and Paul, telling about the signs and wonders God had done among the Gentiles through them." It's very important to listen to one another when trying to resolve a conflict. Like the second part of James chapter 1, verse 19 says, "Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak." Listening will help you to consider the issues. So our last sub-point is, you need to consider the issues. Peter supported Paul and Barnabas by focusing on the basic issue on how the Holy Spirit was at work in new ways with the Gentiles. Peter spoke of what he had seen firsthand and what the Holy Spirit did back at Cornelius' house. We read in verses 8 and 9 that of Acts 15, "God, who knows the heart, showed that he accepted them by giving the Holy Spirit to them, just as he did to us. He did not discriminate between us and them, for he purified their hearts by faith." To discriminate against the Gentiles meant to oppose God. This led Peter to conclude in verse 11, "No, we believe it is through the grace of our Lord Jesus that we are saved, just as they are." And James went on to further explain that though the assembly quoted scripture, they misunderstood it, as scripture foretold the inclusion of all the Gentiles, as we see in verse 17. Although James and Peter came from traditionally Jewish backgrounds, they gave a very fair hearing to consider the merits of the case. We too should always consider the principles involved, not just personalities or past experiences.
So, we have seen that some conflicts are necessary, and to solve conflicts in a godly way or from scripture, we must meet together, listen to one another, and consider the issues. Lastly, conflict should be resolved. In the end, it's always best when a clear decision is made that will benefit the church and advance the gospel. Decisions require judgment. And we see in verse 19, James is saying, "It is my judgment, therefore, that we should not make it difficult for the Gentiles who are turning to God." And in verse 22, it was decided that clear communication be sent to Antioch, Syria, and Sicilia, that all people were to be invited into the church, regardless of their background although not all practices were allowed as written in verse 20. So because Paul and Barnabas made their stand and the conflicts were carefully considered, a new day of freedom came to the church. So what lessons have we learned here? We need to be sure we are not putting unnecessary blockages in front of people exploring faith in Jesus, as well as defining church too narrowly. We have also seen that though some conflicts are necessary, we should do our best to approach them in a godly way to resolve them. We need to clearly document, as verse 20 tells us, and communicate the agreed decisions to all those concerned. Paul and Barnabas were among those chosen to send the letters to the churches. After all this progress, it seems sad at the end of this chapter to read that even Paul and Barnabas had a big conflict later, and they went their different ways. But even that worked out for good, because Barnabas and Mark went their own way and advanced the gospel, and so did Paul, who teams up with Silas. Together they did great things, and later we see that Paul regards Mark with respect and love and wants to see him. So today, whatever situation you are in, you can be confident that the Lord will bless you and help you when you stand firm, when conflict is necessary, and when you always do your best to face and resolve conflict. Let's pray.
Peace on earth and in our lives comes first when the human heart is changed. Agitation, aggression, and arguments must first be cleansed from our own hearts. And that can only happen when we ask for the blood of Jesus to wash away our sins and give us peace within. If that is what you wish to do, please pray with me. Lord Jesus, I want to have your peace in my heart and make peace with others. Please cleanse me from sin by your blood and take the anger and bitterness from my heart. Forgive me for all my bad actions, attitudes, and words. Heal my heart and help me follow you and bring healing to others. Amen. If you have prayed that prayer, then we welcome you to the family of God. Please contact us so that we can help you in your growth as a new Christian.
Now we want to pray for those who are watching who are experiencing conflict in this time. Maybe there is conflict in your home, in your family, or maybe in your marriage. Maybe you're facing conflict in the workplace or because of your faith in Jesus Christ. Let's pray now for a new softness and for a new willingness to see all conflicts resolved. Lord, today we want to pray for everyone watching the service who is experiencing a time of conflict in their lives. Please forgive where there has been stubbornness, pride, anger, hard-heartedness, and division in homes, marriages, and families. Lord, we ask that by your Holy Spirit, you will soften any hard hearts and put a new spirit of love, unity, and peace in each person, in every home and family. We ask that you bring new humility and gentleness and a new desire to see all conflicts resolved in a godly and God-glorifying way. Lord, where situations seem impossible, we ask that you would do a miracle to see even the most long-standing and difficult conflicts resolved. And we pray all this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Well, thank you, Robert and Maria, for this very important message. Thank you for the very, very good example of your own lives and board. Also for being such faithful team members. One of the most encouraging developments for us over this pandemic has been to see how you and so many others have come together with a new level of unity and faithfulness.
Well, today, even though we can't all be together, we want to remember how our Lord Jesus, through the shedding of his blood on the cross, not only made it possible for us to be reconciled to God, but also to be reconciled to one another. And when everybody repents before God, we can take of the bread and the wine with a clear conscience.
So today, let us read once more these words from the Apostle Paul in 1 Corinthians 11, verse 23 to 29. For I received from the Lord what I also pass unto you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes."
Amen. Verse 27 continues, "So then, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Everyone ought to examine themselves before they eat of the bread and drink from the cup. For those who eat and drink without discerning the body of Christ eat and drink judgment on themselves." That's a very serious statement. The body of Christ is, of course, the Church of God, the people of God on earth. Let's examine our hearts right now, and then we're going to take of the bread and the wine. So those of you, I believe you've been prepared for this, so let's get the bread ready, and let's get the wine. Okay. So let's, yes, let's take of the bread right now. So take some bread and maybe just have some for yourself, but also to share with others. So if you're ready with your bread, we're going to just take of the bread in remembrance of him. Thank you, Lord. Let's thank the Lord for his goodness, his mercy. We're here because of the grace of God. Salvation is by his grace. Our access to God is because he shed his blood. He was the Lamb of God who died, who was slain to take away the sin of the world and our sin. Now, when you're ready, if you take of the grape juice or wine or whatever, let's drink the wine also in remembrance of him, and know that this is not just looking back, but it's looking forward. So that's my name. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Now let's pray together. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your great love. Thank you for giving your only Son, Jesus, to come to this earth and to die for us, to forgive our sins, Lord, and to give us a new life, Lord. Thank you for all you have done to bring us close to you and one another, Lord. Today, Lord, we remember you and we give our lives afresh to you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen. Well, God bless you all wherever you are. And we pray that we can get together on a more regular basis, both in the smaller groups and in larger gatherings. But the Lord is with you, and take and you can eat of the bread and the wine, you know, on your own every day, or you could with your family. So let's always remember the Lord and thank God for this wonderful time together in this service.
There's a grace when my heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire. Standing next to me, there was another in the waters, holding back the sea. Should I ever need reminding how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden, without a doubt.
Thank you for joining us today. If you have any prayer requests, please contact us at hello@kcionline.org. If you wish to find out more about our church, please visit our website at kcionline.org. If you wish to stay connected with us, please go to kcionline.org/connect and fill in the form online. If you wish to find out more about giving, please go to kcionline.org/giving. To catch up with any of our services, please go to kcionline.org/podcast or simply download the KCI app on the App Store. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channels at King's Church International and our senior pastors, Wes and Adriana Richards. We welcome you to join us again every Sunday at 10 a.m. God bless you.